Thank you. Please be seated. On behalf of the family, I'd like to welcome each of you as we've come to reflect and to remember of Jim's life. And the presence of family and friends is invaluable as we take this time to be able to lean upon each other as we also lean upon our Lord. Let's bow our heads together as we pray. Our Father, we thank you for your love and grace and mercy. We thank you, Lord, for the reminder that you are with us. Lord, even as we go through life, even as we go through struggles, and even as we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And Father, we thank you for your presence. We thank you, Lord, that not only do you provide us that comfort here on earth, but Lord, also the reminder of the joy of the resurrection, the joy that we have through the sacrifice and the love that you have placed upon us. Father, guide us as we go through this time of service, and Lord, to take time to reflect and to remember, and Lord, to lean upon your goodness and upon your grace and upon your mercy. Amen. Was blind, but now
morning, everyone. Sorry to be standing here under this circumstances, but it's the way it is. I'm just going to share a couple short little things about my good friend Jim. Mostly about golf stuff and stuff he said playing golf. One thing that I've learned from him that I still use and the guys that play with me now is, you know, you get in trouble, say under a tree, you know, and then he'd do his eyebrows. You know, he had the facial expressions like nobody else. He'd do his eyebrows and go, "Watch this." Those that play golf knows nothing good ever happens when someone says, "Watch this." And I still use that to this day. Another thing, he'd come to a water hole and get in his bag and dig around and come out with like a beige tan ball. I'd say, "Man, is that thing made out of leather stuffed with feathers or what?" He'd just laugh. This is the best one. You know, Jimmy could move that ball for a man of his stature. He could move that ball with his driver off the tee box, man. Hit the prettiest little draw. And the first time I played with him, we got on number 4 over here on the new course, and he'd hit a couple of good drives. He gets up there and swings away, and that ball just takes off to the right while it's still in the air. He goes, "No intent." And he's already putting a peg in the ground. But I said, "What is that? Are you taking a mulligan?" He said, "No, that was no intent behind that one." I always thought that was real fun. All right, so I'm going to sing a song, mainly to play this guitar up here. That's the reason I'm playing. So Judy bought Jim this guitar. Did you buy it new for him? She bought it new in 1964. It's a 64 Gibson. And about 12 years or a little more ago, I don't know, he just stopped playing, and he wanted me to have it. So he sold it to me for $400. I've done some research. It's worth 10 times that. And I really appreciate it, and I'll always cherish this guitar. So I'm going to sing a song that's mostly about life and a little bit about death. And that's what we have. We live just about all of our life. We just die for a little tiny fraction of it at the end. So here we go. If I mess up, I'm going to use that no intent thing, by the way. See the road melt into the mountains away as I drive and make it out of this old town alive and not let the dreams I shelter die. Cause I'm moving at God's speed, only God and my mama know what I need, and I feel the hardwood floors on my knees
stories of me and all my old friends. And I'd laugh about how we all thought it won't end.
No intent.
How we all wind up where we begin. Moving at God's speed. We're only God and among us know what we need. And we feel the hardwood floors on our knees as we beg the world to bring us to our feet. I'm moving at God's speed. Only God and my mama know what I need. And I feel the hardwood floors on my knees as I beg you just to take it easy on me. I'm moving at God's speed.
Okay, this is a little embarrassing. I was handed something to read that I left back on a chair in the back. Does anybody have something that looks like this that's got a poem about golf? Look around at your stuff. I don't know where it went. And I don't have it memorized, so. Hey, there it is. A winner! If somebody's got it, I'll read it. But I want to tell you about Jim and my relationship. We moved here in 2010, and I happened to be playing golf over at the new course. Those of you that know him know he lived on number 9T at the new course. And I was out just walking one afternoon, walked up on number 9T, and I looked and I saw this TCU flag on the back of his house. And I said, I like your flag. There it comes. So anyway, we stood there for, I don't know, 10 or 15 minutes. Okay, yes, this is it. Somebody has this as well, but we'll see. But anyway, we just stood there for a few minutes and talked, and I was class of 69, Jim, and you guys are ahead of me. But we just kind of got to know each other there. And through the years, we would, you know, we'd talk. I work in one of the golf shops, and he'd show up, and he'd always be gritching about something when it came in. And so, you know, I'd kind of put up with him and then send him on his way. But we had lots of good conversations. My favorite ones, though, were when we talked about TCU football. And we would talk, and there was one thing that was always certain about Jim. It didn't make any difference who the quarterback was. He didn't like him. I mean, he didn't like Andy Dalton. He didn't like Max Duggan. And I'm sure right now he doesn't like the Hoover kid. But Jim, it's gonna be okay. He's a good kid. But we just had a good time, just always kind of going back and forth at each other. And you know, those of you that know him, he could be a little cantankerous at times. You know, so you just had to, if he did, you just had to throw it back in his face and say, Jim, just take a deep breath, step back away from the ledge. It's going to be okay. So anyway, he was a good friend of mine. I treasured the relationship, and I'm going to miss having those TCU football talks. So anyway, here's the thing I was supposed to read, if you'll bear with me, because I don't have my glasses either. But this one's a little larger print, so that's good. Okay, this says, it's gone golfing. If the round should start without me because I have passed away, cherish the swings that we once made, and please continue to play, for I'll be watching from a gallery with a magnificent view, with friends and family from past, all cheering with pride for you. May each tricky putt find the hole, your drives fly far and straight, and when you've taken your final shot, let's meet at the pearly gates. I have a tee time booked in heaven on the grandest course of all, and we'll go golfing once again, chasing that little light ball. Thanks.
One of the joys we have of coming together and taking time to reflect and to remember is sharing the stories with family and friends. One of the challenges of that in a service like this is the fact that there is only a short amount of time. So I do encourage you as we take time to reflect and to remember to follow up with those stories and things that bring Jim to mind, and those things that make you laugh, those things that through struggles perhaps and times that he had in his life. As we reflect back, we just in looking at his life, we know that Jim was born in Dallas, Texas, to James and Evelyn Mulhollan. Jimmy grew up in Oak Cliff and graduated from Sunset High School. With his family, he attended the Methodist Church. He went on to attend, as has been very well established today, Texas Christian University, or TCU. He also attends Stephen F. Austin, which you may or may not realize, where he was a member, again, both the Sigma Chi fraternity. As a young man, he served as a medic for one tour in the Air Force Reserve, and his career as a builder allowed him to leave a lasting legacy through the homes that he constructed in Possum Kingdom, as well as Fort Worth. He was married to Judy Mulhollan, and together they shared a deep passion for TCU sports, especially with the football team. Jim and Judy spent 20 years here in White Bluff and found joy in playing golf and spending time with friends, with a huge chunk of the time, again, talking about golf, as we've seen, and TCU, and also his beloved pets. If you knew Jimmy, you knew that he liked to kid around. He also liked to tell stories of life events, things that happened, and things that he liked to maybe embellish just a bit to be able to tell a good story. One of those stories actually involved me. Just not too long ago, I was driving down my street, and Jim and Judy live on the street that I live on, and as I passed by, Judy was actually laying in the yard with an elbow up, and I just kind of glanced as I came by, and then I went a little farther, and I realized she may need some help. So I turned around, and I stopped. I got out of the car, and I asked her. I said, "Judy, do you need some help?" And she sheepishly said, "No, I'm just pulling weeds. It's all okay." Well, about that time, Jimmy walks out of the house, and I tell him the story, and we both laugh about it, and of course, I drive off. It wasn't until I was speaking with Judy about the service that I found out that story had taken on a life of its own, that he told the story throughout White Bluff and to his friends in Fort Worth, the story about the preacher that stopped on the side of the road to help a poor lady out. And so, anyway, but that story is one that I hold and something we share together. He loved to tell the stories. He loved to laugh. It's truly one of his lasting legacies. Jimmy is survived by his loving wife, Judy, and sister Marilyn, and two nieces, Alexis and Whitney, his beloved dogs, McKenna and Skeezitz, is that right? Okay. And five cats. He's preceded in death by his parents, James T. Mulhollan, Sr., and Evelyn Mulhollan. Jim led a life marked by hard work, dedication, and enduring love for family and friends. So as I said, it's difficult in a time like this to reflect upon one that has shared so much of your life together. We gain hope through God's word and through the truth of God's word. And as we read and we know that there's life and then there is death and there is sadness, but also there is a hope beyond all hope. In John chapter 14, beginning in verse 1, Jesus is comforting the disciples, and he says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, for I am going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to where I am, that you may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going." Thomas, one of the disciples, asked him and said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. As we think about that, we travel a journey called life, and we travel, and there are various ups and downs and highs and lows. And Jesus says to those that are grieving, let not your hearts be troubled. Let not your hearts be troubled. He says, believe in me, lean on the promises of God's word and what I have taught you. He says, I'm about to depart, but I go to prepare a place for you, and I will come again. So as we walk upon this journey of life as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, we know that life is so very temporary. And as we get older and older, we realize those who we grew up with or those that we have worked with that they are passing from this world to the next. And there is sadness and there is sorrow with that. And we should always feel comfortable and know that even Jesus grieved at a funeral. There should always be that time to be able to mourn. But also there's the reminder that not only do we have the presence of the Lord as we walk upon this earth, but in all eternity. He says to us today two things. One is to trust me. Trust can sometimes be a difficult thing to grasp. On the journey, it can be difficult. Thomas, the disciple, asked that question, Lord, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know where you're going. And Jesus, instead of giving him detailed instructions, said, just simply follow me. He says, know me. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the light. We wonder, what's around the corner? What's next? How long? There are a lot of questions we have in this world. And the reality is, we don't know the number of miles that we have before us. We don't know the circumstances, but we are assured of the continual presence of our Lord. Though we don't always acknowledge or recognize him, he has been with us and will be constantly with us, leading and guiding us. So there's not only a trust me, but trust me all the way home. Life is not a sprint, but it's a marathon. And it's full of ups and downs and highs and lows, and we hit walls and we break through barriers and we continue to trust him all the way home. There comes a point in all of us when the miles come to a close and when our time on earth is over. And Jesus reminds us that the trust we have is not limited to this earth, but for all eternity. Not only do we have our earthly life and earthly belongings, but we have another home awaiting for us. Not only to trust me, he says, but for all of us to trust me all the way home. 2 Timothy 4:6 says, Paul says, I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. Coming into our heavenly home is based upon our walk with Christ who paved the way. It's a decision, as we think about that journey of life, a decision of faith that each of us makes if we accept Jesus as our Savior and Lord, to take that free gift of salvation for us, that eternity is based upon his sacrifice and upon his love. Jesus, who says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. There is no other path but through Jesus. He is the ultimate victor, the one who has been victorious in death, and the one who leads us to eternal life. Paul also speaks to the church in Corinth, and he records the words of Jesus who said, listen, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. We stand here today, and we come here today in a time of grief and a time of sorrow and a time of loss, but we also have that hope and the joy of the resurrection, that there is that reminder that as we place our faith and trust in him, that he has conquered death, that he has conquered all the difficulties of life that we face, and as we place our full faith in him, we have that assurance of eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let's pray together. Our Father, we thank you for the assurance of your presence. Father, we thank you that as we go through a time of loss and mourning, Lord, that you call upon us to trust you all the way home. And Father, along the way that you have revealed yourself to us, and Father, we pray that we can look into the mirror of our lives and know, Lord, that the only way to salvation, the only way to gain that heavenly home, Lord, is through you. And Father, we thank you, Lord, for that opportunity. Guide us, Lord, as we continue to reflect upon Jimmy, reflect upon his life, Lord, to put our full faith and trust in you as we take the time to mourn and to remember, and Lord, to give him truly to you in your presence. And we pray these things in Jesus' name.
First of all, Judy, all of Jimmy's Sigma Chi brothers want you to know that we consider this an honor to take part in this rose ceremony today in remembrance of Jimmy. Brothers in Sigma Chi, rise. We are gathered here to pay our tribute of love and respect for the memory of our beloved brother, James Thomas Mulhollan, Jr. All honor to his name. We meet because of his passing from our circle to the chapter eternal. And yet in our hearts is the confidence that his living spirit hovers near. To his dear ones and friends present, we would bring our expression of sympathy. And to his memory, we would offer our homage for his qualities of heart and mind. As a friend, as a brother among us, and as a man of affairs, we have known him as loyal and devoted to the high ideals of the white cross which we wear. His friendship was enduring. His generosities were large, and his life was an inspiration. He loved his fraternity, but he knew that its helpfulness and sympathies were meant to be broader than the bounds of the organization. His loyalty was grounded in the faith that fraternalism stands finally for the better citizenship, for a more noble civilization, and for the higher ideals of life in its service to man and reverence to God. In this sacred place and reverent moment, the thought is dominant that life and its true friendships are indestructible. Because of the spirit in man, death cannot have the victory. That which we call death is but the gateway to the life immortal. For the life of the spirit does not die. Inasmuch as our deeply beloved brother wore over his heart the white cross of Sigma Chi, whose immaculate whiteness symbolized to us the purity of his motives, therefore, it is most appropriate that he now bear above his heart our emblem, and that we lay white roses here today in token of the sweet memories we will always cherish of him we love so well.
In a moment, we're going to pray, and again, appreciate you being here and being part of this service. We'd like to invite you to go just right next door to our fellowship hall. We have a time of reception and give opportunity to speak more with Judy and the family and to be able to, again, share some of those stories that you have. And Judy, you know that we're here for you, that you have, again, a host of people that are here supporting you as you go through this time. As we come together, I invite you to stand as we have our closing prayer, and we'll conclude on the Lord's Prayer. Lord, we do thank you for the opportunity to gather this morning. We thank you for the songs that we've heard, and Lord, the words and the thoughts and the testimonies, Lord, of Jimmy's life. And Father, we thank you for your word and knowing that we are people of hope, Lord, an eternal hope that's based upon you. Father, we thank you for Jimmy's life. We thank you, Lord, for the ways in which you've worked in so many ways. And Father, we come before you knowing that truly that all the hands could have done have been done. And Father, into your hands do we commend the Spirit. Now, Father, guide us as we go through our journey of life, or to lean and depend upon you, to seek you, and Lord, to pray, even as you have taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.